Let's begin by just looking at a simple picture where we have poured two lava flows. These are actually poured within about 15 or 20 minutes of one another at exactly the same temperature. It's the same material. It's still both poured on dry sand, just different slopes. The first one we poured was on a 20 degree slope. And on this 20 degree slope, I think you can see the lava flow is very narrow. It has these nice levees. It's a rather thin lava flow, and it flowed down about 2 meters down the slope. In comparison, if we look at the second flow we did, again, same temperature, just changing the slope to 10 degrees, we can see we got a much fatter, much thicker lava flow. It's much broader, did not travel as far down the slope. Actually, you can look at the folds on the surface and see that they have a slightly different form as well. It's kind of thickest in the middle and doesn't have the levees or channelized aspect of the one that was poured on the steeper slope. Now these are extreme examples, but they really show how important just the slope can be.
Okay, we're getting ready to do a series of pours here, side by side once again. The first thing we're gonna do is pour down the far side, which is about a 13 degree slope with a big step in it that's about 6 inches high. And then that goes down to another slope that's about 10 degrees, something like that. The lava flow is very sensitive to the slope, the morphology and the behavior of the lava flow. So we're just gonna sort of unclog the spout here and we're gonna be ready to pour it out. We're pouring once again on dry sand to minimize any sort of interaction with the material underneath. So we've turned down the furnace now, and it'll start to cool down slowly as we go along here. We're using the FLIR camera once again. Have geology students here who are working on the project, recording data, the temperature data for us. And Bob's gonna divert the lava flow, pour into our Y-shaped diverter here that Noah's built. And, you know, we're used to pouring this now. You can just tell by the way it splashes out there that the viscosity's low, the temperature's high, and it's gonna flow relatively rapidly. We're gonna pour a pretty big batch here now out of this side, so it will go down that step. And okay, the lava is just entering on to the sand here. You can see how it's dark where the crust is starting to form. That crust is resisting the flow. It's trying to hold the flow back, but gravity's pulling the lava down the slope. And you can see it's a nice uniform kind of lava flow as we've made in the past. And as we continue to pour here, the lava is going to reach that step and eventually go over the step. The way it's going right now, it looks like that crust is forming so strongly on the front of the flow that it's gonna probably have to have a breakout before it gets over that step, which is, again, very typical. You can see we're still pouring lava in like crazy, and yet the lava flow is slowed down. A thing to look for is the lava flow inflating now as the forward resistance is slows the flow down, but we still add the material to it, so it's got to go someplace. So it basically inflates the flow almost like a balloon. That black skin, which is about 850 degrees C, is very plastic, and it's sort of confining the lava. So the pressure is building up inside there, and as the lava continues to flow in and flow down the slope through the tube, that pressure is going to build up and probably break out down below there. And hopefully it'll do that and then flow out over our step. It's actually a really good illustration of how lava flows through a tube-like structure. You can see the lava in the trough is crusted over on top, but it's still coming out pretty fast down at the bottom of the steel trough there. It's still pouring into the lower part of the flow that you can see is getting very flat and inflated now. And you see the front has lifted up. The lava is still probably pushing down inside of it now, pushing down the hill and trying to make that go. It's interesting, you see how Bob's bashing in the skin there of the lava. You can see how plastic it is. Look, some of the molten material squirted up there. Yeah, it's still molten inside. You can see he's hitting it, and it's not shattering, it's not breaking or anything like that. Just a little bit of crust. It's still very gooey and plastic. And they're just trying to shape it up there so that the next pour will come down the trough in the other direction here. Oh yeah, we broke out the lava flow, the pressure broke out on our lava flow, and it's cascading over the top. You can see it's piling up at the bottom, and there's a lot of pressure in that little lobe at the bottom now, so that might have its own breakout. But that's, oh, that's beautiful. Look at that. Okay, so even though we'd stopped pouring the lava in, just the pressure of the lava, molten lava, inside the tubes that were connecting the upper part of the flow to the lower part that was inflating, we could see it inflating, getting fat, that was enough to break the skin and cause that breakout on the side that then spilled over the slope. And it looks like going over the slope has cooled down the lava quite a lot. It's allowed it to make a really strong crust. So it may well be done now on that side. Here's a little piece we pulled off the spout. You can see how finely that lava streams out. In fact, the thread-like bit fell off the end. I'm having trouble holding it because it's still really hot. Remember, this was just melted rock just a few moments ago. The very fine hair-like strands that are made are called Pele's hair. Look how thin that is. It is just like hair. Pele is the goddess of fire, the goddess of volcanoes in Hawaii. When the wind blows, when there are volcanic eruptions in Hawaii, the basalt is blown out, just as it was sort of stretched out by when we pulled the spout back here today. And we make quite a lot of this stuff during our experiments. We also have Pele's tears. Here's a tear right here. A big droplet of lava that sometimes also gets wind-blown in Hawaii. There's also something called limu'o pele, Pele's seaweed, that's made when bubbles form, and it makes a sort of ropey, messy, seaweed-like tangle of material.
So in this session, we've really emphasized the effect of the slope, and actually, more fundamentally, the role of the crust that's not really viscous anymore. It's this other weird material that's really controlling the way the lava flow is behaving. In the next session, we're going to look at the third important parameter, the rate at which we're pouring the lava, or what we would call the effusion rate in natural lava flows. We're going to see that that's also a very important control on the way lava behaves and the way lava flows end up looking.